الحمد لله الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على سيده المصطفى صلى الله تبارك وتعالى عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. وقال تعالى فمن يرد الله أن يهديه يشرح صدره للإسلام ومن يرد أن يضله يجعل صدره ضيقا حرجا كأنما يصعد في السماء. وعن عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله تعالى عنهما قال لما تلا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فمن يرد الله أن يهديه يشرح صدره للإسلام فقيل له ما هذا الشرح يا رسول الله؟ فقال صلى الله عليه وسلم إن النور إذا قذف في القلب انشرح له الصدر وانفصح. فقيل هل لذلك من علامة يا رسول الله؟ فقال صلى الله عليه وسلم نعم، التجافي عن دار الغرور، والإنابة إلى دار الخلود، والاستعداد للموت قبل نزوله. آمنت بالله، صدق الله مولانا العظيم، وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم، ونحن على ذلك لمن الشاهدين والشاكرين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. علماء اكرام، respected elders, brothers who are listening, members of the congregation, young friends in Islam, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I thought of discussing one particular hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it is something that is very pertinent to each of us and to every Muslim around the world. There is one particular dua that Muslims, whether they like it or not, they beg, they beseech, they supplicate, they ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at different times during the day. One particular dua is asked by Muslims of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at different times during the day. And at those different times during the day, these Muslims ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that not one time, but multiple times. Again and again, repeatedly, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that. And that is that we beg Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for guidance. In every rakat of every salah, whether it be an obligatory prayer, a fard salah, a nafil salah, Eid salah, Jummah salah, every single salah, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for guidance. اهدنا الصراط المستقيم. O Allah, guide us to the straight path. And perhaps the correct translation of this would be, there is two ways of guiding. The Mufassirin write that there are two ways of how you can guide a person. If I ask a person, where is this Myra Masjid? Then either he can tell me that go straight, turn left and turn right, or the person can hold my hand and take me there. When we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for guidance, we are asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to hold our hand and guide us. Not just to tell us where the road is. And therefore, the Mufti Taqi Usmani Sahib, Namaz Barakatuhu, when he translated this verse, he translated it as, Ihdina Sirat al-Mustaqim, take us on the straight path. He did not say guide us, take us on the straight path. In other words, hold our hand and take us. So we ask this dua of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at different times during the day. And we beg Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on multiple occasions, multiple times at these different times during the day for the guidance. So it shows that this guidance which we need and we, it is something that is very, very dear to all of us and it is very, very important for us to have. There is one particular hadith which Hazrat Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu narrates. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu was known as Afqahu Sahaba, min Aftahi Sahaba. He was known from among those Sahaba ikram radiallahu ta'ala anhu who were most understanding of the temperament of the Sharia. They understood what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam wanted when he made a statement. They understood the depth of the statement of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So Hazrat Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he narrates and he says that, and maybe I should digress a little bit, on one particular occasion, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, just to show you the caliber of the Sahaba and how the Sahaba wanted to practice, implement, internalize, how they wanted to practice upon the sayings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is so important for all of us. On one occasion, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was addressing a group of Sahaba. And there was a little group that was sitting there, and there was some Sahaba who was standing on the edges of that gathering. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu was not there. He was coming into the gathering. He was coming into the gathering. And this Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam addressed the Sahaba and he asked those people who were standing at the edge, he said, Ijlisu, sit down. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu was not there, but he was entering the masjid where the shoes were kept. He sat down dead in his tracks, despite understanding what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam meant, despite understanding who was being addressed, but his body did not allow him to move after he heard the command of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to sit down. This is marzi uski hardam jiski peshe nazar hai, for uski zabaan pe na agar hai na magar hai. We must remember that the Urdu poet says that marzi uski hardam jiski peshe nazar hai, to phir uski zabaan pe na agar hai na magar hai. He says that the person who wants to be obedient to Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then on his tongue you will never find excuses. You will never find him saying, but if that or but that, no ifs and buts on his tongue. And the one who wants to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he does not justify anything. He does not look for wisdom in everything. He does not say that, you know, the beard was for those days when there was sand in the desert and now things are different. He does not say, make excuses. Just Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying something is sufficient for him to implement, to practice, to internalize. So this Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says that there was a particular verse of the Quran Sharif that was revealed. فَمَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ أَنْ يَهْدِيَهُ يَشْرَحْ صَدْرَهُ لِلْإِسْلَامِ. This verse was revealed. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recited this verse. A brief translation of the verse is, فَمَنْ whosoever yuridillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants ayyahdiyahu to guide, yashrah, he opens up sadrahu, his chest, lil Islam, for Islam. Whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wishes to guide, Allah ta'ala opens his chest up for Islam. So the Sahaba ikram radiallahu ta'ala anhu, they were very eloquent in the Arabic language. They understood what I just said now, the translation of the verse, they knew what it was. But these Sahaba ikram radiallahu ta'ala anhu, they asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ما هذا الشرط يا رسول الله يا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, what is it that the chest becomes open? What is it? Of course, what it means is the chest becomes open, it starts accepting the teachings of Islam, the ahadith of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, wholeheartedly you start accepting without questioning. This is what it means. They knew it. But that was not what they were asking. It leads us to a very important point. And that is a misconception that we have. We feel that if we learn a little bit of Arabic, or we have attended some course in Arabic, then it is sufficient for us to comment on the Holy Quran, on the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These Sahaba ikram, whose mother tongue was Arabic, who were born speaking the Arabic language, who died speaking the Arabic language, who used to write such poetry in the Arabic language, that literature is testified to the level of poetry that they used to write. These Sahaba ikram radiallahu ta'ala anhum also dared to comment on the Quran Sharif of their own will. Yet we find amongst us people who would dare to comment on the verse of the Quran Sharif, dare to comment on the ahadith, that this is what it means, because I have studied Arabic and this is what it is. Let us be very, very careful when we choose to comment on the Quran. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the person who says something or comments on the Quran Sharif without knowledge, without adequate knowledge, then despite, even if he is correct, he has erred and he has made a mistake. Even if he is correct, he is wrong. So we have to be very, very careful when it comes to commenting on the Quran. Nevertheless, these Sahaba ikram, they asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ما هذا الشرح يا رسول الله. So now we must remember what they are asking. They are asking, Rasulullah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran Sharif that whoever Allah ta'ala wants to guide, he opens his chest up for Islam. Remember, we are asking for that guidance multiple times during the day. So this hadith is very relevant to us. We want to understand what this opening up of the chest is all about. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ النُّورَ إِذَا قُذِفَ فِي الْقَلْبِ إِنْ شَرَحَ لَهُ الصَّدْرُ وَانْفَسَحَ. That this guidance, this opening up of the chest, oh my Sahaba, it is a special light. It is a special noor which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places in a person's heart. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places that noor in his heart, then this person starts accepting the teachings of Islam wholeheartedly. Now this person does not have ifs and buts, there's no questions about the teachings of Islam. There's no justification. There's no saying, but it was like this in the time of the Prophet and it's not like this now. Such a person then practices. So it is a special type of noor which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking about. So that clears up some parts of it for us. We understand that when we are asking for guidance, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم, O Allah, guide us, then we are asking for the special type of noor, so that we can easily accept the teachings of Islam. But the Sahaba ikram radiallahu ta'ala anhum did not stop there. They asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, هل لذلك من علامة Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that is there any sign, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that a person has got this noor in his heart? Because they wanted to know. They were asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for guidance all the time. They wanted to know, is our dua accepted or not? Do I have that noor in my heart or don't I? Do I still have to work for it? So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, qala na'am. He said, yes, there are three signs to know whether this person has got that noor in his heart or he does not have that noor in his heart. And he mentioned three signs in few words. The first thing he said is At-tajafi an daril ghurur. The first sign to see whether a person is rightly guided, whether we can, and we all have to monitor ourselves. Far too often it happens that when we are listening to a bayan, then we are quick to judge the next person. Let me see if the person next to me, he's got these qualities or not. And we don't check within ourselves whether we have got the qualities. Our objective is to worry about ourselves, whether we have these qualities or not. And these are important qualities for every believer to get. So he says, At-tajafi an daril ghurur. That this person who has got this noor in his heart, who is rightly guided in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, tajafi means disinclined. He is disinclined towards the place of deception, towards this world, its possessions, its properties, its vehicles, its electronics, everything of this world. This person who has got this noor in his heart, he is disinclined towards all of that. He's not inclined towards that. Rasulullah, and this is such an important point. So many of us might feel that if a person is rich and he has wealth, then such a person cannot have this quality. But this is not the case. The person who is rich and he has wealth, he can also be disinclined towards the dunya. There were many Sahaba ikram radiallahu ta'ala anhum who were very, very wealthy people. And if you have to convert their riches and wealth into our times today, maybe the rich amongst us will also be poor. Maybe the rich amongst us will also feel ashamed when they see the wealth that some of the Sahaba ikram radiallahu ta'ala anhum had. But that wealth did not cause them to deviate from the teachings of Islam. That wealth did not cause their moods to fluctuate. It was one of those things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed them with it, they were grateful. If they didn't get it, then they were patient. Then they had sabr. But they were disinclined. It wasn't the major thing in their life. It wasn't the main thing of why they lived. It wasn't like that. And therefore, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to teach us that when we make dua, then ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allahumma la taj'ali dunya akbara hammina. Oh Allah, don't let the dunya be the most important thing in my life. وَلَا مَبْلَغَ عِلْمِنَا. Let it not be the be-all and end-all of my knowledge, that if I have any knowledge, it's how to make money. وَلَا غَايَةَ رَغْبَتِنَا. Ya Allah, don't make it the thing that I desire the most in my life. Let it not be like that. And Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, on the occasion when the Roman empires and Persian empires were being taken over by the Muslims, and outside Masjid al-Nabawi, there were heaps and heaps of gold and silver and carpets from the Persian Empire and so much of wealth of the dunya. Then Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he made a special dua on that occasion. He said, Ya Allah, the love of these things, I do not ask you to remove it from our heart, because you have placed the love of these things in our heart. وَإِنَّهُ لِحُبِّ الْخَيْرِ لَشَدِيدٌ. Man loves the dunya. He's intense in his love for wealth, for property, possessions. I do not ask you to remove this love from our hearts. But what I do ask you is that to make the love for the akhirat, the love for the things that you love, dominant in our hearts. The love for those things should be more. That is what this inclination towards the dunya means. You are disinclined towards the dunya. It does not affect you. It's one of those things. Jalaluddin Rumi rahmatullah alayhi on one occasion gave a very beautiful example, and he said that a man is like a ship. A man is like a ship, and the dunya is like the water around the ship. So for that ship to sail from one place to another place, it needs the water. Can the ship go from one place to another place without the water? It can't go. And can you have one glass of water only, or one bucket of water? One bucket of water, or you just put one swimming pool full of water, that also is not enough for him to go. You need an ocean of water to go through life. Like that, man requires requires dunya to go through life. Without dunya, without clothes, there is destruction. Without wealth, there is destruction. Without food, there is destruction. So you need dunya, and you need a lot of the dunya. So that water helps the ship to go through life. Like that, wealth helps an individual to go through life. But if that very same dunya, that same water comes into the ship, so long as it is outside the ship, it helps the ship. But if that same water comes into the ship, it causes the ship to sink. Like that, Jalaluddin Rumi rahmatullah alayhi said, that dunya, so long as it is outside a person's heart, it will help the person to go through life. But the minute it becomes part of his life, he becomes inclined towards it. From morning to evening, the only thing he is thinking about is how to earn, and how to make more money, and how to get the next person's wealth. If that is the only thing that he is thinking about, then that very same wealth which would have helped him for his akhirah, that very same wealth becomes a means of his destruction. At-tajafi an daril ghurur. That the person should become disinclined towards the dunya. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned another quality of these people who are rightly guided, who have the noor of Islam in their heart, the noor of guidance in their heart. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, "Wal inabatu ila daril fulud." That these people are perpetually inclined towards the akhirat. All the time their focus is on the akhirat. Their focus is on the hereafter. Their focus is on jannah, on trying to earn jannah and trying to prepare to protect themselves from jahannam. This is there. And if we have to study the Quran Sharif, then hardly a page of the Quran Sharif goes by where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not mention the akhirat. It is full, every page of the Quran Sharif virtually has mention about the akhirat. Every page. On one occasion, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has taught us one particular dua that we read when we get up in the morning. Alhamdulillahi alladhi ahyana ba'dama amatana wa ilayhi nushur. We all know this dua and we recite it. But what does it mean? It means, oh Allah, we thank you for granting us life after death. Because when we were sleeping, we were as good as dead. And you have granted us life again. So that was enough. But right in the morning, in the beginning of the day, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, say also, wa ilayhi nushur, that you are going to return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right from the time you get up in the morning, then remember your akhirat. Can you ever see a person who has the akhirat in front of him and disinclined towards the dunya? Can you ever see him deceiving anyone, lying to anyone, cheating with anyone, disputing and quarreling and fighting with anyone when he knows the temporary nature of this life? Can you find him doing that? When he knows that life is temporary, life is transitory, we are in a transit lounge. Those who travel, and they go to the airport, when you sit in the lounge, let it be the economy class lounge or business class lounge or first class lounge, do you now start rearranging the furniture there and you start doing funny things there as though you're going to stay forever? No, it doesn't happen like that, because the man knows in a few minutes it's my flight, I'm going to be gone from here. Like that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, قُلْ فِي الدُّنْيَا كَأَنَّكَ غَرِيبٌ. Live in this world like a traveler. Then he said, no, not even like a traveler. أَوْ عَابِرِ سَبِيلٌ. بَلْ rather live in this world أَوْ عَابِرِ سَبِيلٌ. The traveler still has some bags and that he takes with him. You live in the world like how when a person is crossing the road, he crosses the road, you live like that in this world. There's the person who is crossing the road, does he take his suitcases and go? He doesn't have anything when he's crossing the road. You live in this world, just something that is necessary for him to pass by through. He has a little bit of that and he crosses the road. Remember the akhirat at all the time. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at all times, he would remind the Sahaba ikram radiallahu ta'ala anhum of the akhirat. On one occasion, the Sahaba ikram radiallahu ta'ala anhum, there was some very soft cloth that had come from Yemen or some Syria or some other place. Very, very soft in texture. And the Sahaba were admiring this piece of cloth. Now it was not wrong for them to admire it. They could have admired it. They could have seen it. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he saw them, he said, لَمَنَادِيلُ سَعَدِ بْنِ مُعَادٍ فِي الْجَنَّةِ أَلْيَنُ مِنْ هَذَا. Oh my Sahaba, the handkerchief that Sa'ad ibn Mu'adh radiallahu ta'ala anhu has been given in Jannah is softer than this. You don't have to now, you know, the only thing that we talk about nowadays is this seat in the business class, that, this, that. These are the only things that we speak about if we speak about things. Worldly possessions. Let us be focused on the akhirah. So that is the second thing that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that the person is inclined perpetually towards the akhirah. That is what he is doing. And the third quality, the third sign to show that the person is rightly inclined, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَالْإِسْتِعْدَادُ لِلْمَوْتِ قَبْلَ النُّزُولِ. That the person prepares for death before it comes. This person who is rightly guided, he is preparing for death before it comes. A lot can be said about how we must be preparing for death, because death we don't know when it is going to come. Our Shaykh Hazrat Maulana Hakim Muhammad Akhtar Sahib Rahmatullah Alayhi used to say, Zindagi ka ajeeb hai visa, kab bulale khuda nahi maloom. He said, this visa of life that we have, it is a very, very strange visa. We have all got visas and we came into this world. But it's a strange visa. The normal visa that you get, you know when it's going to expire. And if it's expiring, you can extend it also. But this visa, you don't know when it's going to expire, and there's no way you can extend the visa also. Death is going to come suddenly. So we have to prepare for that death that is going to come. And if a person is rightly guided, then that person is preparing for death all the time. So a lot can be said about it, but I just mentioned one incident about how the pious of this ummah used to prepare for death. There was a tabi'in by the name of Hazrat Abdul Rahman ibn Abi Naum rahmatullah alayh. He was a tabi'in, a person who saw the Sahaba. He did not see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but he saw the Sahaba. And he was a great scholar and alim of deen. And great ulama used to sit in his company as well. So one day, a person came into that gathering and asked a very, very interesting question. He asked all these ulama who were sitting there that if you knew that you are going to die tomorrow, then what would you do? So this is an interesting question, especially if you have to ask the ulama, you have to ask scholars, pious people, then it gives us some sort of guidance. as to what we are going to do. You know you got 24 hours to live. How are you going to prepare for that ultimate meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So, someone said that he would do something, and some other alim said he would do something, and someone said something else. When it came to the turn of Hazrat Abdul Rahman ibn Abi Nawm, he first tried to deflect the question. He said, no, no, let's get on. We already have the answers of everyone. Let us go on doing our work. So they insisted, no, we want to hear, what is your answer? So when they insisted, he said, the reality is that my schedule from morning to evening and from evening to morning is such in the preparation of death that if I know that I'm going to die tomorrow, then there is no room in that schedule to even add anything else on. There is no room in that schedule to add anything else on because I'm preparing for death all the time. So even if I know that I'm going to die tomorrow, there's nothing else I can do more to prepare for death. At least we must be aware. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَخْتِمُ أَخْتِرُوا ذِكْرَ هَذِمِ اللَّذَّاتِ الْمَوْتِ. Remember in abundance the thing that is going to cut off all pleasure. Everything is going to be cut off. All pleasures are going to be cut off. Remember that thing in abundance, and that is death. Because death, remembrance of death, will protect you from a lot of evil, will protect you from a lot of vice. And if you don't remember death, you don't have. That is why we remember the Akhirah. We remember that we have accountability. In Islam, we are so fortunate. If you don't have that, then you will need police to police the police also. If there's no accountability, you'll need police to police the police. We have special police that check that the police are not doing anything wrong. Don't you have that nowadays? Investigators to see that there's no sort of fraudulent transactions, no bribes, no this, no that. So we remember that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the guidance to imbue within ourselves these three great qualities. To be disinclined towards the Akhirat, to be inclined perpetually, to be disinclined towards the dunya, to be inclined perpetually towards the Akhirat, and to strive to prepare for death. If we have got these three things, then we have to, we can say that that guidance is coming our way. But even if a person has it, it is an ongoing constant effort to retain it in his heart till his dying moment. That is what it is all about. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us these qualities. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remove the problems, the difficulties, the calamities that the ummah around the world is suffering with. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala assist and help all Muslims in any part of the world if they are suffering any type of difficulty.